When the Space Shuttle was announced in 1972, it was seen as the space vehicle to make low Earth orbit space travel and living in space an everyday reality. But in hindsight, many now believe that it was a failed project that was hamstrung by lack of funding and interest by the government and sky-high expectations from NASA that led them to sideline safety to ensure that scheduled launches continued on time in order to secure future funding. Instead of expanding man's horizons, it in fact limited them and stopped the development of more effective, safer forms of both manned and unmanned space transport. It ultimately became the deadliest space vehicle in history and more expensive than the expendable rocket systems that it was meant to replace. Yet it wasn't meant to be like this. NASA had originally proposed the Space Transport System, or STS as it was known, which was a system of reusable manned space vehicles in 1969 as a successor to the Apollo program. The STS was going to consist of a permanent space station in low Earth orbit, a small, cheap space shuttle to transport astronauts to and from the Earth and to the space station, a space tug to move men and equipment to different Earth orbits, but could also double up as a lunar lander, and a nuclear-powered spacecraft to go between the low Earth orbit space station and the Moon and possibly onto other planets in the solar system. The two main goals of the STS were to reduce the cost of space flights by replacing the then current rockets like Saturn V that had taken the men to the Moon but could only be used once with reusable spacecraft. The second was for it to act as a support vehicle for NASA's more ambitious goals of permanent manned space stations around the Earth and the Moon, and then manned missions to Mars. Wernher von Braun, the architect of the Moon missions, wanted NASA to follow up Apollo and go to Mars, and the military liked the idea of a reusable shuttle to deliver its satellites and do other things. However, after the success of the Apollo missions and the race to put a man on the moon was over, public and political interest in further manned missions waned, and Congress became unwilling to maintain the huge funding, which had peaked at 4.5% of the federal budget in the late 1960s, so it was cut to a fraction of that in the early 1970s. Based on this, Nixon chose to reject the STS and manned missions to Mars and go for just the space shuttle, but in an upgraded form that would allow it to carry both men and payloads. This suited the military and the Nixon administration, but due to the cost cutting and the need for the shuttle to be seen as an all-purpose transport system, the design has, in hindsight, become to be seen not only as compromised, but also inherently unsafe, and in the long run, exceedingly expensive, the very things that it was supposed to avoid. The shuttle system was to use external solid rocket boosters, or SRBs, to help it get into space, whilst the shuttle's main engines were supplied with liquid fuel from a massive external fuel tank, which the shuttle and the SRBs would be attached to. Unlike previous space launch vehicles, which were self-contained liquid fuel rockets, with the main modules and the crew at the top and away from the fuel and the exhausts. The use of the SRBs and the external fuel tank were down to the Pentagon wanting high-capacity payloads for its satellites and the Nixon administration to keep the cost down by reusing parts. Some say that trying to achieve reusability with early 1970s technology forced design decisions that compromised both safety and reliability. The reusable main engines were made a priority, which meant that a new design with new materials were required. The refurbishing of these after each flight turned out to be more expensive than building new existing design ones like those used on the Saturn V and allowing them to burn up on re-entry. Because the main engines were mounted to the shuttle and not to the launcher, the payload area was also significantly reduced. This design of having the shuttle strapped to a giant supercooled fuel tank and then having effectively two uncontrolled rocket motors that once fired could not be turned off, in time led to the failures of two of the five shuttlecraft and pushed the operating costs almost as high as the flights themselves. Compared to the Russians and Chinese, the only other nations to operate manned space missions, the shuttle has turned out to be the deadliest space vehicle in history so far, with the loss of 14 crew, 2 of the 5 shuttles, and 2 of the 135 shuttle missions. This works out at a vehicle failure rate of 40% and a flight failure rate of 1.5%, a figure which was borne out by Richard Feynman in 1986 at the official inquiry into the Challenger disaster and 17 years before Columbia. Feynman said then that NASA's management's own estimates of one flight failure for every 100,000 flights was wildly fantastical. And after he anonymously polled the NASA engineers themselves of what they thought the odds of a failure would be, he came back with an average figure of one failure in every 100 flights. We have now had the benefit of seeing the entire shuttle program through to the end, and the actual failure rate was one failure in every 68 flights, which is nearly 1,500 times worse than NASA had predicted it should have been. The Challenger disaster of 1986 was blamed in equal parts on the failure of one of the seals on one of the SRBs because of the unusually cold launch conditions, and NASA's management that had attempted to launch at all costs, even when warned that doing so could lead to the loss of the entire vehicle. But if the design had been different and hadn't used the SRBs, then this failure would not have been possible. Equally, the breakup of the Columbia on its re-entry in 2003 can be traced back to the failure of the heat-resistant tiles on the underside of the left wing of the craft. This was caused by flying debris falling off the main fuel tank and damaging the tiles at launch. This flying debris, which was a mixture of insulation foam from the main fuel tank and ice from the atmospheric condensation, was a common occurrence and well known about. In fact, impacts with the shuttle had happened on a regular basis, and missing tiles can be seen in this shot of the shuttle whilst in orbit. But the foam had not been designed or expected to fall off, and the thermal tiles had not been designed to withstand any impacts with debris at all. It was this gradual acceptance by NASA managers of more events outside the design tolerances, simply because they had not caused a catastrophic failure before, that enabled the design flaw of strapping the shuttle to the side of a fuel tank where frozen debris could fall off and hit the shuttle, meant that in reality it was only a matter of time before an accident like that of Columbia would happen. If the shuttle had been mounted on the top or away from the fuel tank, as main modules were on previous launch vehicles, or even if the thermal tiles had been redesigned to withstand minor impacts, the loss of Columbia could have been avoided. One of the main goals of the shuttle was to bring the cost of space launches down. It was envisioned by NASA's engineers that each shuttle would fly up to 50 missions per year, but in reality, the complexity of the shuttle maintenance and repairs took months between flights, and this reduced the average number of flights to about 4 per year for the entire fleet. In 2011, the final cost for each shuttle flight, when allowed for design and maintenance, had been worked out. It was approximately $1.5 billion, or about $27,000 per pound of payload. This, in comparison to the originally envisioned costs of around $118 per pound in 1972, or approximately $657 adjusted for inflation to 2013 levels. The expendable Russian Proton cargo launchers, which are still based largely on a 1965 design, is estimated to cost around $110 million per flight, or around $2,300 per pound. And the 2014 prices for Elon Musk's SpaceX are between $1,000 and $2,500 per pound for communication satellites. Since the end of the shuttle missions, the only way to get people to and from the International Space Station has been by the Russian space agency Soyuz rockets. And although the cost has never been officially publicised by the RSA, it is believed to be around $80 million per launch, which is still much cheaper than a shuttle, and it has operated with a 100% success rate and zero fatalities. It's rather ironic to think that the system developed by the Soviets to prove communist superiority in the space race, and which was derided by the USA, is now the most reliable and the most commercialized in the world. In 2007, NASA Administrator Michael D. Griffin wrote a paper in which he said that if the Saturn program and commercially available boosters had been continued instead of developing the shuttle, it could have provided 6 manned launches per year. 2 of them to the moon have the capability to lift heavier payloads, and all for the same price as the shuttle. He also said that if we had done this, we would have been on Mars by now instead of just writing about it, and we would have had decades of experience operating long duration space systems in Earth orbit and similar decades of experience in exploring and utilizing the moon. Adopting the shuttle kept new, more efficient and safer designs from NASA out of the skies and led to the growth of the private spacecraft industry, which is now doing what the original STS program was going to do, but without the hindrance of government policy, depending upon which way the political wind is blowing. The main difference between these and the shuttle is not a technical one, but they have been designed to be profitable commercial spacecraft from the outset, made from commercially available parts from a private enterprise chain with paying customers, including NASA. It's now expected that NASA will be looking to give the business of moving men and materials to places like the International Space Station to the private sector, which can do it cheaper and better and leave NASA to the job it's best at and also wanted to do in the first place, which is pushing the boundaries of what can be done and sending men to Mars. That's if the private sector doesn't get there before them. Thank you for watching. I hope you enjoyed the video, and if you did, then please thumbs up, subscribe, share, and comment. And don't forget, we have other videos available which you may also find interesting on the link which is showing now. So until the next time, it's goodbye from me.